One idea in the history of astronomy, a very old one originating with the ancient Greeks, is the notion of a counter-Earth. There have been several versions of this idea, but most recently it was the suggestion that there could be another Earth in the same orbit, always on the opposite side of the Sun, meaning we can't ever see it because the Sun always blocks it. Counter-Earth appears in early science fiction in the 19th century, but more recently, though not all that recent at this point, a version was depicted as having started out as a kind of counter-Earth in Doctor Who as the planet Mondas, the homeworld of the Cybermen. It did not, however, stay a counter-Earth, as Doctor Who fans will know. The space age ended this notion, however, as we gained the ability to send out spacecraft and take a wider look at the solar system. Counter-Earth was simply not there, and the dynamics of it are such that it would eventually become visible anyway, due to interactions with Venus in particular. But strangely, that wasn't always the case. There are a number of ways that objects can share orbits. This is known as a co-orbital situation, and we see it with asteroids and planets in the solar system. One major form of this would be a double planet system, that are also orbiting each other along with orbiting their star, a configuration that Earth actually fits. The Earth-Moon system is co-orbital in this way, and the Moon is very large to the extent that some have called it a double planet. I do not wish to stop calling it the Moon, though. It's quite literally the archetype for moons everywhere. Ever since Pluto got demoted, I don't think it would be fair to give the Moon a promotion. And really, what has it done to deserve it? But interestingly, the Earth-Moon system seems to have been the product of a different kind of co-orbital. Early Earth, really proto-Earth, shared its orbit in some way with Theia, which resulted in a huge glancing blow collision that threw off the material that formed the Moon. Theia was once a kind of counter-Earth, and that impact outlines one of the issues with planets sharing an orbit. And it gets weirder. We know that at least part of Theia ended up deep inside the Earth. There's evidence of a pair of plumes near Earth's core that may be remnants of at least part of Theia, and the Moon also incorporates material from it. However, there are two mysteries. In order to throw the Moon's material into space, the blow was thought to be glancing, meaning that part of Theia may still be out there. And this in turn may answer another mystery. The planet Mercury is an anomaly, in that it has an iron core much larger than it should be expected to have. This may mean that it actually started out as a larger planet, and some sort of impact stripped it of much of its mantle. That puts Mercury on the list for being Theia. And that means that Mercury was once a kind of counter-Earth, at least sharing an orbit or parts of its orbit with Earth. The interesting thing about this is that we should be able to establish whether Mercury really is Theia with a sample return mission. The samples can be tested for isotope ratios, and if they look like the Earth-Moon system, then that would be solid evidence. If the isotope ratios are all wrong, then it would eliminate the possibility. Likewise, if we ever found a meteorite that could be linked unequivocally with Mercury, the same test could be done from the comfort of home. But as of right now, there are only candidate meteorites for an origin at Mercury, no smoking guns. So while we currently do not have a counter-Earth, we do have a twin of Earth, at least in size. That's Venus. While it currently is a hostile mess, other than the upper reaches of its atmosphere, which oddly is the most Earth-like environment in the solar system, not on Earth, it may not be hopeless to terraform Venus in the far future. And there are several ways to do it, but the chief problem is the thick carbon dioxide atmosphere. It would basically need to be almost entirely removed. There are ways to do this, however. Carl Sagan suggested using genetically engineered organisms that fix carbon dioxide into organic compounds. But since this has been shown to not be viable past a certain extent, you would not remove the CO2 through this means alone, and Venus has very little hydrogen, which is necessary for this method. Another option is to sequester the carbon dioxide into carbonate minerals. So in this regard, Venus and Earth are opposites. Most of Earth's carbon dioxide is sequestered into its geology through the carbon cycle. Venus does not have this. Most of its carbon dioxide is in the atmosphere, not the geology. Interestingly, the equilibrium of Venus is such that its atmosphere and its geology are in a very unstable equilibrium, meaning that if you upset it, it would start removing carbon dioxide and sulfur dioxide from the atmosphere, and as a result begin to cool the planet and its atmospheric pressure would drop. Models showed that this could remove nearly half of Venus's atmospheric pressure, and drop the temperature down to 127 degrees Celsius or 260 degrees Fahrenheit once the minerals are saturated. That's a start. Then to continue, start digging and exposing more minerals from the crust until you eventually get the atmosphere where you want it. This would normally take thousands of years, however this process is much faster. And this is useful for Earth as well in removing CO2 from the atmosphere using polystyrene microspheres. That gets it down to as little as 75 days. And the reaction is exothermic, meaning it produces useful energy. You won't be able to do it quite that fast overall though, because estimates have said you'd basically need to till the surface of Venus down to a kilometer globally to get this to work, to get it to Earth-like levels where you could introduce plants to begin oxygenating it. Other ideas include injecting the CO2 in basaltic rock where it would mineralize, which also might be used in tandem with the earlier method. Another option is bombarding Venus with hydrogen, which will react with the carbon dioxide to make graphite and water. Sources for this would need to either be a gas giant, or other major source, or the sun. It's also possible that Venus has large deposits of hydrogen deep in its interior that could be tapped. Iron aerosol will also be required. This would have the effect of restoring Venus's oceans, which interestingly, since that planet has such flat topography, that ocean would cover about 80% of the Venusian surface. It would have more ocean area than Earth does, even though it would only end up with 10% of the amount of water Earth has. Very flat indeed, with very shallow oceans. That would eventually leave an atmosphere of mainly nitrogen at about 3 times the pressure of Earth's atmosphere, but that would further drop as the oceans absorbed nitrogen. There are many other methods of potentially reducing Venus's atmosphere of varying practicality, such as somehow removing the gas directly and sending it into space and so on. There are also methods to cool Venus, usually involving starshades. But the point here is that it is not all that out of reach to consider that eventually someday, Venus may be made into a habitable world. Indeed, it has the potential to be the most Earth-like of all the other planets when the terraforming is finished. It is a place that someday you could conceivably take your space helmet off and breathe the fresh, artificially induced air. But there's another option hidden in here that might make it even more Earth-like. Migrate Venus into the habitable zone and make it into counter-Earth or something like one. The first problem here is how to migrate a planet, but the answer is straightforward. You pass a series of asteroids past a planet to nudge it into a different orbit gravitationally. This is on the table for future Earth as the habitable zone expands if we're still around. We'll need to migrate along with starshades and eventually moving the planet outward. This is a dangerous proposition. Passing asteroids very close to Earth over and over for thousands of years might go wrong and we get hit. But at the same time, it's better than facing the red giant phase of the sun. And with Venus, no problem if anything hits it, so long as there is no one living there. The orbital dynamics of the rest of the solar system, however, may be a problem. I'm not sure moving one planet isn't going to throw it all off, but two or three starts getting difficult to predict. But if you could get past that, you could do the same with Venus, and bring it within the habitable zone of the solar system and park it in a stable orbit. You could actually also do that with Mars and move it further in. Moving planets is a long-term proposition, very long-term, but not impossible, and couple it with terraforming and new possibilities open up. And it's not permanent. A counter-Earth orbit can't ever be stable. It's one of the bad Lagrange points. But if you get it right, you can make it last a geologically long period of time before you have to maintenance it, and prevent one of the members from being thrown into the sun or ejected. And indeed, configurations like that are new technosignatures we might look for in the universe to try to spot aliens, or aliens eventually spotting us. One of these is the idea of arranging planets into an artificial arrangement in a star system, though there are other ways this can be done even without a star. The idea is called a Klemperer rosette, and at its most basic, it is a system of objects orbiting a common barycenter. The most stable type would be groups of identical planets, with each group being of equal mass in a geometric pattern. The configuration would be big planet, small planet, and so on, in types with the same mass around a common barycenter. The problem with these kinds of arrangements, or in co-orbital arrangements in general, is stability. It's possible to achieve it, or curate it, so your planets don't eject each other or collide, but there are probably easier ways to migrate Venus and Earth into stable orbits that aren't exactly the same orbit and achieve the desired effect. The habitable zone is fairly wide. And there's even a long-term stable way to have two planets in two close orbits that actually periodically swap orbits with each other in a kind of dance. There are moons in the solar system that do this. And it has to be said, Venus, Earth, and Mars are not all the same mass. But here you can envision alien civilizations as they colonize other star systems, moving suitable planets into the habitable zones of stars over long periods of time. And the Milky Way is indeed old enough for this to have been done somewhere. But we haven't yet seen it if it has, even though we know of thousands of exoplanets. But that's not that big of a sample as far as the whole. And not only have we not seen any sort of weird arrangements of planets, we haven't actually seen an example of natural co-orbital exoplanets yet. Interesting possibilities indeed. But if we do someday turn Venus into a counter-Earth of one flavor or another, I think we should think twice about populating it with Cybermen. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently thinking about the moon being the archetype of all moons in the universe. Sorry to mention it again, but does that imply that all other moons are just pale imitations of the moon? Take that, Ganymede, though don't tell the moon, it might get an ego. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.